So I had just a prophetic idea while we were worshiping, which is that when the love is like a rock, and it's like a rock, and we can stand on it, and we get lifted up when we are standing on the love of God. And the love of God never fails, like rocks don't fall apart. And we are surrounded by the love of God. And God's love for us is so all-encompassing. And we can stand on it. He covers us with his love. And we are blessed. So I was thinking of this rock. And, you know, Moses struck a rock in the wilderness. And water came out for the people of God. And I think they traveled with that rock. They took it with them. I don't know, because, like, where'd they get the water? Water was pouring out of this rock. So, anyway, so God, and then Jesus is the rock today. Jesus is the rock that we're standing on. Jesus is where the water pours out for you and I. And God said, "All right, my law's in their hearts." Hallelujah. So we are filled with the love of God, but that is Jesus. That is, Jesus is the love of God. Hallelujah. So the last time I was here, I shared a message about repenting. Anybody remember? And like, repenting isn't something we do once. I told a story about in the spring, and you know, it wasn't spring then, but it's spring now. Yep. And in the spring, you got to walk around your yard and pick up all the branches that fell during the winter when you weren't walking around outside. And you pick them up and take them over to the pile where you put branches. And then I walk around my yard and I go, "Oh, there's a whole lot more branches. They're not as big." But now I got to walk around and pick up little branches. And then if I want to keep going, I go, "Oh, there's little sticks now." I mean, I could walk around my house about 5 times picking up stuff every time. And it's the same way with repenting. When we get born again, we believe Jesus and we repent. And we, our life becomes changed. But it's not perfect yet. God said that Jesus perfected us who are being sanctified. So, which one is it? Am I perfect or am I being sanctified? So, if we die, we're perfect, you know, and we're enter into God's house. But we're here, we're being sanctified. Okay? So the way that we get sanctified is interesting. And we get sanctified by repenting. Anybody know that? And so how many people have a testimony of something that they repented of since the last time I was here? All right, come on up and give us a testimony. Here, I'll bring you the mic since you got a job to do.
Since you last, I mean, there's so many I'm trying to think of one to share.
Oh, yeah.
Well, one thing that came up was, here's one. So, you know, we're gonna have a son in September, and things come up like housing. Like, you know, we've been renting, and, you know, we never really like thought about buying a house and all that, but now since we have a family, that's a natural like desire that's God put in our heart. And one thing that the Lord brought up to me is I had to repent because my father, like about 20 years ago, he was in the real estate business. And it did really well, but there was a time with the housing crash where he lost all his money. And then I remember agreeing with the fact that I said, "I'll never have a mortgage in my life. I'll never like get into that kind of stuff." So I had an agreement saying all those things were bad. And the Lord said, "If you want a home, you gotta repent and stop thinking those things are bad." So I just like released all that. So yeah,
Praise God. Super. Father, I bless this brother and say, Lord, he's going to have a beautiful home. In Jesus' name. With his wife and his child. Hallelujah. Anyone else have a testimony of something they repented of? Well, I repented of complaining. One day I began to see that God loves me even more than I knew he already loved me. And I realized, oh man, God always loves me. And he doesn't anyway. And it dawned on me, you know, I don't need to complain. You know, and I couldn't find anything good about complaining. I thought about it a little bit and I said, no, I don't, I really don't need to complain. I could just drop it totally. And I did. Hallelujah. God loves me. I repented of complaining and now I don't complain anymore. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Who else has a testimony of something they're okay?
Many people here know about this. So, you know, during a healing session that we were having with Tina, you know, I decided that I needed to repent over the feelings that I had over my father and release forgiveness. So I did that amongst brothers. We prayed about it. And maybe like 3 weeks, a month later, my father reached out to me. My father lives in the Dominican Republic. And we were able to connect after 21 years.
Super.
So now him and I are establishing a relationship and moving forward. So that was really powerful.
All right. Father, I ask you to bless this brother's father, hallelujah, yes. And the relationship between the two of them.
Yes.
And that he'll be able to share Jesus
yes.
with his dad.
Yes.
Amen. Hallelujah. So my dad, when I first got saved, he said, if you mention that again, I'm going to knock you down. and then he goes, and if I'm on my deathbed, I'll get off it and knock you down. Anyway, but by the time he was getting really old, he was a Christian. And I prayed with him several times and accepted Jesus, and his caregiver was a Christian and he loved God. And on the day he died, my wife and I and my brother and his wife and my sister and her husband were all holding his hands, and the radio station had changed from rock and roll to, it was Sunday night Christian music. And his last breath, the station's playing, Nearer My God to Thee. And my brother goes, wow, I really feel God. And he's not a Christian, really, not yet. Anyway, so as we associate with people throughout our lives, if we're friendly, we'll get a call when they're at the end of their life, when they want to know God. You know, but if we're obnoxious, the phone's not going to ring. So it is good to be friendly, even with people who don't know Jesus, because there'll be a day when they want to know what we have.
Yep.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Jesus. Does anyone else have a testimony? Well, I do have a message. I say, God, I need a backup in case we don't get too many testimonies. What if no one repents? What happens then? Then no one grows. Can you imagine a church where no one is growing? Can you imagine an orchard where no trees are growing? Can you imagine a farmer's field where no plants are growing? No growth is just, that's not God. Hallelujah. God is growth. And in Matthew 13:18, it says, therefore, hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom, so Jesus told the parable first, but now he's explaining the meaning of the parable to his disciples. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, then the wicked one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is he who received the seed by the wayside. But he who received the seed on stony places, this is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. For when tribulation or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. Now he who received seed among the thorns is he who hears the word and cares, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. But he who received seed on good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. What is the difference between type 1, 2, and 3? Well, the first never repented. The second repented and had joy, but when temptations came, they fell away. And the third repented, but the cares of riches and the pleasures of this life bring no fruit to perfection. So what do we expect to get when we plant seeds?
A harvest.
A harvest of what?
The seed you planted.
Right. More seeds. More of what you put in the ground. Hallelujah. So,
thank you.
How many people know that Jesus said, you must make disciples?
Yes.
In Matthew 28:16, then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee. So this is after Jesus was resurrected, to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. And actually, that's the final verse in Matthew. Go, make disciples. So we're born again, Holy Spirit filled disciples of Christ. And Christ expects more disciples.
He does.
Hallelujah. Yeah. That's what Christians bring. You plant them and they bring more disciples. Hallelujah.
Beautiful.
And Acts 1:6. This is the beginning of Jesus' ministry. Acts 1 is before he ascended into heaven. But this is about the last thing he said before he went up. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, Jesus, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? So they had this idea that Israel was going to be victorious, that Jesus was going to, you know, show up in a white wagon and chase away all the Romans and etc. And he said to them, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses of me in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth. So we are to be witnesses of Jesus. Jesus says, don't worry about when the kingdom is going to be restored to Israel, when the kingdom is going to be restored here, when the war is going to end there. You know, somebody was talking about how bad things were, and I just learned a song. It's from 1934, and it's like, In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was looked on as something shocking. Now heaven knows, anything goes. The world has gone mad today, and good's bad today, and black's white today, and dark's night today. Oh, it's like nothing's changed. 90 years ago, they were saying, this is bad. Terrible. Isn't that what we say today? Right? You turn on the news, you watch TV. Oh, it's just, anyway. So, don't worry about that. Yeah. Witness of me. You are witnesses of me. So, we are born again, Holy Spirit-filled disciples of Christ. Christ expects more disciples. Okay, so what does this have to do with repenting?
Everything.
In Hebrews 5:12, for though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God. You have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness. For he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Did Jesus grow in his earthly ministry? Yeah, he was born as a baby. At 12, he talked to the teachers in the temple. He grew into a man. He ministered in the power of the Holy Spirit for 3 years. Then he gave his life on the cross. Then he descended into hell and defeated the devil. And then he ascended into heaven. But this man, Hebrews 10:12, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. From that time, waiting till his enemies are made his footstool. For by one offering he has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. So we are perfect forever, but we're being sanctified.
Yep.
And in other words, God doesn't want to leave us the way he found us.
Yes.
He's going to make us better. Amen. And repenting is how we see the obstacles that we need to get across to become sanctified,
amen.
Better, improved. When I got the idea that I didn't need to complain, like that was a revelation for me. Okay? But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us, for after he has said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them. Then he adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. So you are perfect. God has forgotten your sins and your lawless deeds. But you're not sanctified totally, because God wants to even improve you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. And there is a lot of growth in church. Repenting is something that we need to incorporate into our lifestyle, because as we repent, the lid comes off.
Yes.
And we what's the right word? Rise. Mm-hmm. We rise. And that's what Christians are to do for one another. And we make Christians as Christians, but for other Christians, we lift the lid off their heads and they come up.
Yes.
They what's the right word? They become sanctified. They become holier. They have a greater revelation of what they need to do for God and what God expects them to do. Hallelujah.
Yes.
This is why there are so many stuck places in the Christian life. If I go left, I lose. If I go right, I lose. If I stand still, I lose.
Yep. That's, yes.
What is God waiting for He's waiting for me to pray, to fast, to press in, and see the way out. God wants me to pray, fast, press in, and get the revelation of how this is going to work. And probably somewhere in there, I will repent.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Hallelujah. Yes, and that's God showing his love for me. God loves me so much that he wants me to grow. Mm-hmm. That's why I get stuck, because there's areas in my life that I haven't got the revelation of how I should proceed.
Yep.
And I go forward, boom, and there's a policeman here and there's a policeman there. And anyway, and God likes to show me off too. He likes to show me off to the devil. Hey, yep. Look what this guy did. Oh yeah. That's in the Bible too.
Yep.
But there is always a way out. God allows us to go and get stuck so that we can see. So that we can see. He wants us to see. He's going to help us to see. And when we get stuck, that's when we learn that there are more ways to see than we knew before we got stuck. Hallelujah. Why would he do that? Because he loves us and wants us to grow. I was thinking during worship of Paul, and Paul said, he said, to keep me from being conceited because of the surpassing greatness of revelations which was given to me, I was given a messenger of Satan to harass me, a thorn in my flesh. And I sought the Lord 3 times that it would be taken away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. So Paul found out how to get unstuck. And he said, therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Hallelujah. So that's an example. I mean, Paul is an example. Paul is, I think, the chiefest of the apostles. He preached to all the Gentiles. Peter preached to the Jews. So, and Paul didn't get to walk with Jesus for 3 years. Paul got it all from the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And he only spent 15 days in Jerusalem with the apostles.
Sorry.
I went to Bible school in India for 15 days. Hallelujah. Wow. And I operated all 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit when I was there. And you know what I found out? It was the anointing of the teacher of the Bible school that allowed me to operate all 9 gifts of the Holy Spirit. Because when I left, they didn't operate. So then I had to work, you know, to develop them in my life. But at least I had a taste. At least I knew what I was looking for. Hallelujah. Anyway, so 15 days he can get a lot accomplished. But I think Paul got most of what he accomplished from the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Now, we know the parable of the sower, that some will fall away. But God is looking for people who will press in, pray in tongues, ask for help praying, and even fast to discover the way to go. Hallelujah.
Yep.
And the blessings of God are indescribable. God is good. Heaven is only the long-term plan of God. He has blessings for us right here on planet Earth. But those blessings are hiding behind things we don't see. Behind walls we can't see through. And when we do see the obstacle, we need to repent, change our thinking. That's what repent means. To turn around, think another way, and God will make it clear to us how to achieve the goal that we want to get. Our Heavenly Father loves us, is proud of us, shows us off to the devil. He blesses us, heals us, solves our problems. He lifts us up, gives us credibility, honors us. And even if something goes wrong, He welcomes us into heaven. What a wonderful God we serve. Hallelujah. He is so good.